It's Thursday, August 27th, 2020. I'm Greg Nibbler, and this is Digital Trends Live. Yes, indeed. Hello, everybody. This is Digital Trends Live. I'm Greg Nibbler, and thanks for joining us. Wherever you are, we appreciate it. We broadcast live here every single weekday, 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern, bringing you trending tech headlines, news, interviews, discussions, and more. So thanks for joining us. Hit subscribe, share the show. Let's get you started off with some news. So the CEO of TikTok, Kevin Mayer, has resigned amidst the pressure the company is facing to divest itself of all connections to its Chinese parent company, ByteDance. So to give an overview, TikTok has until November 12th to either find a new American-based owner or leave the U.S. market and turn over all the data it has acquired on its users. It's expected that the company will sell, but it's still up in the air as to who that will be. So right now, Microsoft is the leading candidate publicly. However, other companies have also stepped forward with interest since there are about 100 million active TikTok users in the U.S., according to recently released numbers. Software company Oracle is one of the leading potential suitors, who's also maybe teaming up with some of the original companies that invested in ByteDance to make an offer. Twitter emerged as a somewhat unlikely buyer, but still, along with Apple and Amazon, plus there are Netflix rumors now, and maybe even Walmart and SoftBank possibly teaming up. Everybody wants a piece of TikTok. So Mayer released a letter internally to employees saying that he expected they would reach a resolution, quote, very soon on the sale. And a report from CNBC also said a deal could be reached by next week and that the sale price could be $20 to $30 billion. This is all happening while a lawsuit against the U.S. government makes its way through the courts, and TikTok even opened up a merch store selling hoodies and t-shirts that say, not going anywhere and here to stay. So this is a big development with the CEO leaving. Expect some changes probably imminently. Follow along at digitaltrends.com. As the U.S. election looms ever so larger, social media platforms continue to attempt to temper the amount of misinformation and abuse that happens on their platforms. Twitter's been adamant about trying to label tweets containing dangerous false information about coronavirus or those that incite violence, but now they're going after copypasta. Copypasta is a term for essentially a block of text that is copied and pasted over and over, and in the case of Twitter, sent out as identical tweets by multiple accounts. It's pretty much spam. And if you've ever been on Twitter for any amount of time, you've seen it, particularly when it comes to bots and political messages, which is one of the key things that it's been used for in the past. If you see the same exact wording and reply posted over and over, it's most likely copypasta. It's also been an issue for creators on multiple platforms, but certainly on Twitter, when someone basically steals someone else's post and makes it their own. So the key thing to be determined is how to stop it from happening, and that's what Twitter is tackling now. So Twitter said they'll be hiding tweets that feature copy and pasted text that has no modifications from its original source, and they updated their censorship policy to include copypasta as a violation. They also said they may limit the visibility of tweets that are labeled as copypasta, but whether that's by placing a warning over them or blocking the post entirely remains to be seen. Where this will most likely show up first, though, is on some of those more popular political threads. So be on the lookout to see how they handle the bots. You can follow along with all the latest details at digitaltrends.com. Amazon has announced a new fitness band and app service that uses your camera to scan your body. So between Fitbit, Apple Watches, Galaxy Watches, more, the fitness band market is huge. So it was inevitable that Amazon would join in, but this is definitely a different approach. It's called the Halo, and it's part hardware and part subscription service, but no screen. So the band itself just looks like a bracelet and has a sensor module in it that features an accelerometer, a temperature sensor, and a heart rate monitor. But Amazon did say the Halo is not a medical device, so it doesn't have FDA approval like some of the other ones do. It also has an LED light and two microphones. The microphones are not for phone calls or using the assistant. They're for monitoring your voice. So the key features for this device are in the app, and there are two that are unique. The first is the tone feature, and it listens to your voice throughout the day if you opt in and makes an assessment of what it thinks your emotional state is. They said it doesn't record or store your voice, but makes note of the pitch, intensity, rhythm, and tempo to then let you know what state you might have been in throughout the day, whether it was worried or happy or a bunch of other emotions. The other unique feature is the body function. This is where the scanning happens with your smartphone camera. So you're asked to wear some tight clothing, then set up your camera and take a series of photos within the app that will provide a 3D rendering of you that they say can analyze and calculate your body fat percentage. Not sure how I feel about that, but The Halo will run $99, and there is a subscription service you can opt into for $3.99. It'll start off, though, as an invite-only device, and you can read more about it at digitaltrends.com. And while the Epic Games versus Apple App Store fight continues on, there's another report out from an online security firm called Nightline Security that sheds a light on the billion-dollar black market for stolen Fortnite accounts. So according to the report, which was detailed in Bloomberg, criminal organizations are able to cross-check usernames and passwords captured in data breaches and leaks online with Fortnite logins to see if any of them match at a rate of about 500 accounts per second. Then, when they get a hit, they log in, see what the user has, and set a price to sell it. For some Fortnite accounts, and the same goes for some competing games like Minecraft or RuneScape, players could have in-game purchases like skins and extra weapons that are worth hundreds or even thousands of dollars in real money. So these accounts are valuable. The report goes on to say that the accounts usually sell for $200 to $250 a piece, and one of the people selling the accounts said they make $20,000 a day on them. So who's buying them? Well, people who don't want to spend hours and hours building up a character's level or gathering up the special items so they can just buy their way right into the top of the game. For its part, Epic Games said it does use a very sophisticated tech and capture system, including account blocking for multiple login attempts to try to stop it, but clearly it's still working. So there are even some users who sell their accounts and then report them as stolen to get them back, so that's part of it too. And with an estimated billion-dollar black market for this, this is going to be getting some attention as Nightline has shared the report to the FBI. Don't buy stolen accounts. You can read more about it at digitaltrends.com. All right, we'd like to keep you up to date with technology, and I got to sit down with our own editor-in-chief, Jeremy Kaplan, as he unboxed the Microsoft Surface Duo. Let's take a look at that now. This is Digital Trends Live. I'm Greg Nibbler. Thanks for joining us. One of the things we like to do here at Digital Trends is keep you up to date on everything that is going on in the world of technology, and that includes unboxing highly anticipated products like the Microsoft Surface Duo. Standing by, we've got our editor-in-chief, Jeremy Kaplan. He's got it with him. Jeremy, take it away. I am excited to see what is in this box.
I have been waiting to see the Surface Duo for a full year. I experienced it when they first announced it last September or October. They finally have just shipped this to me. This is the packaging that the brand new Surface Duo comes in. Now, this is an exclusive reviewer package, and we usually don't bother showing you this kind of stuff because it's not what you're going to get as a consumer. However, they put so much energy into it, made such a beautiful presentation, I thought it was meaningful to show it off to everyone. So you'll see it opens up wide, just like the Surface itself. And behind this flap, we've got a whole package shown off here, introducing the Surface Duo. There's a new way to get things done. A little detail of the various modes that you can use. And this is a nice little note from Panos Panay himself saying, hey, we put a lot of effort into this. We hope you're going to appreciate it. So you see this reviewer's kit comes with the Surface earbuds. I don't think the actual product does. For $1,400, I would prefer it did. I'm not clear about that exactly. We'll get back to you. Here is the Duo itself. So let's dig into this guy. Now this is what you will get as a consumer, the Surface Duo itself in a beautiful box. Now, unboxings are interesting because the experience of unboxing a device kind of adds to the excitement of actually buying it, right? You've invested all this money in it, here it is. And sometimes manufacturers just throw things in a box, like you'd throw that used cable into the drawer, whatever. You'll get it, you'll get the product, you'll enjoy it. But the act of unboxing it is cool, right? You've been waiting for this thing for a while now. So here it is, soft open, beautiful box. And there it is, the Surface Duo just sitting there. I'm going to pull it out for you here. We'll get there in a second, but let's take a look at what else comes in this package. Underneath this little insert, we've got a little note on the bumpers. So these are bumpers that sit around the side edges of the Duo as protection. You spent $1,400 or more on this thing, you probably do want some protection. That said, it's already not the smallest device, so maybe you don't want it. So nice that it's set aside separately for you there. And then underneath it, we've got a variety of things. Here's some documentation set in a little box. This is your USB charger. And then we've got a USB cord in here, USB-C, of course. No earbuds. We're not talking about that now. I think they're pushing those wireless ones, which is why you don't get any wired version in the box. That said, here it is, the hotly anticipated Surface Duo. And holding it at long last, I'm just thrilled by the experience because look at this. Look at how impossibly thin this thing is. And it's hard to overstress that because you're used to phones being thin and everyone talks about how thin they get. This is markedly thinner than other devices, 4.8 millimeters. and it feels just like a notepad, which is, I think, exactly what Microsoft was going for here. Two screens, feels just like a book, opens and closes beautifully and smoothly. The key is these hinges that Microsoft put all of this engineering work into. They're not just hinges. If you stop to think about it, we have two different panels here. The circuit board that runs this is split in half, and all of the wires connecting the various parts run inside of these hinges. They said they had to come up with a special polymer for those hinges because the cabling couldn't get thin enough, so they had to invent something, and they actually patented it. The software isn't quite ready for us to take a look at, so we're really just here to talk about the experience of the device itself. But I gotta tell you, the experience is wonderful. The motion of opening and closing this thing is fantastic. You can see the various modes that it will be used in. A tent mode like this, great for viewing. A book mode, great for reading a book. Full-on tablet if you're watching something on screen. And what's nice about the hinges that they built here, they have to be capable of doing that, of stopping at any point. And because Microsoft's invested time and energy in this, they can actually do that effectively. The key is now, how does this feel in your hand? It's substantially wider than your average phone. So that feels a little bit different than what you're used to. It's also on the heavy side. It's a slightly heavier, about heavier, the Galaxy S20, the Ultra one that is, which is 7.7 ounces. This is about 8.8 ounces. An extra ounce doesn't really make a big deal, frankly. It doesn't feel super heavy to me. It feels substantial, it feels good. Glass on both sides. If you're used to Microsoft's Surface products, you're expecting some sort of a magnesium alloy, a titanium alloy. No, it's just glass, but it feels really premium. It feels really good. So the software's not quite baked yet. I'm gonna have to go try it out privately, and we'll get back to you on that experience. So I'm about to push the power button for the very first time. I'll be back later to let you know how that experience is.
Fantastic. Jeremy, I think you're right. Just talking about that feeling and seeing it in, you know, not in person, but seeing you use that. Now I see why people are so looking forward to this thing and some of the different functionality. And you're right, how thin it is. I do worry about the glass on both sides because if I, like me, I will drop that. So I'd probably need to figure out some kind of case for it. But definitely cool. And thank you for sharing that. Again, the unboxing right here at Digital Trends Live. And as Jeremy said, he'll have his review of that up. And you can go take a look more about that at digitaltrends.com. Jeremy, thanks a lot.
Always a pleasure, Greg.
Jeremy Kaplan right there, editor-in-chief. So go take a look at digitaltrends.com. We've got more details there. I know he's got something already written up, and he will be giving you his opinions on how that all works right there to follow along with. And hit subscribe to Digital Trends Live. We're live every single weekday, 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern. We'll be back in a minute with more right after this. And welcome back to Digital Trends Live. I'm Greg Nibbler, and thank you for joining us wherever you are. We appreciate it. Robin Williams passed away just over 6 years ago, and his death absolutely had an effect on all of us, anyone who's ever seen his incredible performances or just his comedic brilliance. But a new documentary entitled Robin's Wish is out on September 1st that aims to shed some light on his final days. And we're joined by two people directly involved with the film. First off, to introduce equally, we have the director and co-writer, Tyler Norwood, and a comedian, actor, and friend of Robin Williams. We have Rick Overton. Rick, hello.
Hi, thanks for having me.
I have so many questions to ask both of you, you know, about this film and about your lives in general. But Tyler, I wanted to start with you. Can you tell us, just to sum up, why it is you wanted to make this film?
So for me, when I got a call from Robin's widow, Susan, saying, hey, do you want to make a film about Lewy body dementia? I said, no. And she said, you know, well, it's really important to what me and Robin went through in the last year and a half of our lives. And I said, okay, well, can you tell me some of those stories? Because I don't know anything about that. As a Robin Williams fan, I'd never heard of this disease, especially never heard of it associated with him. And once she told me the stories of what they went through with this disease in the last year and a half of his life, I said, you know, if that's the movie you're willing to make, if you're willing to go there, I'm all in. And that was the path that started us on a 3.5-year journey. That now culminates in 17 people who knew Robin really well, from, you know, big directors like Sean Levy from the Night at the Museum series to, you know, his best friends like Rick and some of his other comedian friends. And the idea that, like, they all stepped up and they all wanted to tell this story of what they saw, because it didn't really get reported. And I think it foundationally changes the way you understand Robin Williams's life.
Well, in talking about what this is, and I'll admit I was unfamiliar with what this is either, when you talk about what the issue was when it comes to whether what he was diagnosed with. Rick, maybe you could just walk us through. I've got some questions for you, but you tell us a little bit more about what it actually is that he was diagnosed with.
It's a form of Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS, and but with emphasis on the dementia and a body dementia where there is loss of acuity and function. And it's a loss of everything that made Robin Robin. It took away the facility of the mind, and it takes it in layers. And he was a mighty spirit that he could fight like that through all of these adversities, compiling and exponentializing and weighing down on him like Sisyphus. And he almost pushed that rock over the edge of the hill. He was so strong in character and will and in mind and in his heart. These strengths kept him alive when it was taking everything away.
You talk about, you know, this film is about a lot of friends who knew Robin. You know, they're certainly involved in this. And Rick, you knowing Robin for decades, I don't know if maybe you could share with us one of your first impressions or memories of performing with Robin.
The first time, you are like a motorcycle getting behind a tractor trailer and you're just letting the suction draft pull you along. You know, you're in the current there somewhere. And then as time goes on, we get to know each other better. We start to see where there's the rhythm and the back and the forth. And, you know, you're measured by how well you keep up with him, not how well you get ahead of him.
Well, talking about this movie, you know, and you knowing Robin that long, and this documentary in general, during the making of this, was there anything that you learned through this film that you didn't know beforehand?
Oh, yeah. Lots of details. Lots of details about what he was experiencing and the technical reasons for it. All of it shows that he went up against something that almost nobody could possibly have lasted that long to have gone up against. He's an extraordinary person. He fought against impossible odds, and he held impossibility in his hands all the time while still going on.
And one of the things with Robin Williams is just, you know, how much joy he gave to so many people. We all knew that side of him. But Tyler, for you, for making this film, can you tell us a little bit about what kind of clarity and answers this movie can give to the rest of us who didn't understand that, you know, private side of his life?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think a lot of people associate Robin Williams as a comedian, right? He was also an incredible actor. Comedian, right? He was this funny guy and he could do these other things, but we all want to stay with the laughs and the joy that he brought us. And so in talking to the people in the comedian community, you know, there is a little bit of a stereotype that goes out there, which sometimes can be applied incorrectly, which is this idea of a sad clown, right? Like the idea of somebody who can make you laugh and bring you to such joy, but when they off stage, when they're in their own time, that they're just dark and sort of beleaguered and worried, you know, this idea of depression and that he couldn't take it anymore. A lot of these narratives that were out there about Robin, that, you know, without Lewy body dementia, without understanding that this was a neurological disease that's incurable, absolutely ends in death. And, you know, was really affecting him at the end of his life. You know, his autopsy report, doctors looking at it, they were amazed he could even walk, right? Let alone speak, let alone do anything else. The idea that essentially he had the mind of a child, right? Because he'd been so worn away. But the idea that this film, I think, brings forward, in addition to those facts, is the idea that the heart of Robin Williams, the thing that we all really connected to on stage, in movies, whether they were comedic or not, was that heart, the heart of this guy, and how it comes through and stayed with him right up until the end, that he was still generous, still kind, never got it, like never got bitter, never got sad, even though he never got a diagnosis in his lifetime, which is an incredible thing, that he never got to know what this thing was. Wow. It was only upon dying. And that's one of the reasons I think it got underreported and that this film is so necessary, is that this is a story that fans almost didn't really get access to until now.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I had no idea about this, you know, until I found out that you were making this film. That is so very important for all of us. Rick, going back to you and going back to your performances with Robin, like, what would you say is, for you performing with him that many years, what's one comedic lesson or tip or piece that you took away from performing with him that maybe you used in your performances?
Don't trust your brain ahead of your gut. Your brain is digital recording. That's all it does, is it remembers the moment your gut came up with a split second before. It doesn't know how, it's not its fault. It doesn't know how to do anything else. It's a recorder. But it's your gut that got you there first. Your gut is brilliant. Robin's gut was a genius and cooperated very well with his genius mind, but it was his tummy that took him there. And if you're studying improv, you'll find it's your gut that gets you everywhere first. And so close to your heart, that those two should always work together through all of this. Always listen to your heart. It's smarter than the other two.
Great advice. No, I want to ask more about this film too, but Rick, I have to ask you, since we have you here, you know, there's a lot of talk about sequels or movies being remade, and Willow in particular, there's been a lot of rumors about a sequel and maybe Ron Howard being involved, but I want to ask you, is your role in Willow something that you would ever want to revisit?
That'd be fun. To see what happened to those two guys after, you know, the story continues on. It's always, we like revisiting characters and films. Who knows? I ran into Kevin Pollak at Whole Foods, and he said he heard about it, and he left a message with Ron's office. And so, you know, everything's a little bit on hold right now, but if it picks up, that would be something to do. Use that Mandalorian scene stuff, you know, to shoot everything. The way they're doing these days, there's ways to pick production right back up again.
Great. Well, I want to remind everybody, too, that Robin's Wish is out on September 1st, on demand and digital. But before we close out, Tyler, I just wanted to maybe ask you, you know, what would you like people to walk away with after watching this film?
Oh, yeah, that's a great question. So for me, the thing that I think this film does so well is it unpacks any of that weight, any of that confusion, any of that, like, sort of sense of, like, who was he really? Like, you walk out of this film, hopefully, with this renewed sense of, like, not only was Robin Williams amazing, but Robin, the guy behind all that work, was even better.
Oh, that's a great way to, something to take away from this. One final question, too, that I had here was just, you know, for everybody who's like me, who's obviously watched the documentary to learn about this form of dementia, but where would you direct people to learn more if they want to go right now to find out about it and what maybe some of the symptoms are for Lewy body dementia?
What I would say is go to our website. We have incredible partners. So 50,000 neurologists signed off on the science in this film. And they're represented by the Michael J. Fox Foundation, the Parkinson's Foundation, the Lewy Body Dementia Association, the American Brain Foundation, kind of the list goes on. But if you go to our website, robinswish.com, there's tons of links.
That's fantastic. So go there, check that out, watch the film. It is going to be out September 1st, so everybody can go take a look at Robin's Wish. And Tyler, Rick, I want to say thank you very much for joining us. Thanks for doing this. Thanks for shedding light on this and, you know, and ultimately celebrating the life of Robin Williams, which was brilliant and wonderful to all of us in so many ways. Thank you. Thank you for being here with us on Digital Trends Live.
Thank you.
Totally our pleasure.
My pleasure.
Wonderful. So nice to talk to both of those gentlemen about this. And again, Robin's wish to shed some more light on what he was going through there at the end and take away what you will from that and learn more about it. So thanks everybody for joining us. This is Digital Trends Live. We'll be right back after this. Stick around. Back in a minute. Hey, welcome back to Digital Trends Live. I'm Greg Niblin again. Thanks for joining us wherever you are. We appreciate it. Hit that subscribe button. Share the show. Hey, Yvonne, thank you very much. We are here, like I said, every single weekday. So thanks for joining us today on LinkedIn Live, whatever platform you're on. Hit the subscribe button. Share the show. We keep you up to date on all kinds of things, and that includes what's going on in the world of entertainment. And that is why we have our own Rick Marshall joining us here for another edition of Real News. And Rick, it's good to see you. And also, I understand we've got some more theater news.
Yes, we're back with really some big theater news this week. There are three major releases that are actually going into theaters. That in itself is such a massive piece of news. Theaters are starting to open up around the country. And three big releases, Christopher Nolan's Tenet, The New Mutants, and Bill and Ted Face the Music are all premiering in theaters over the next couple of days. But how you'll be able to see them, where you'll have to go, when they're screening, and sort of risks you'll have to take to see them kind of vary from film to film.
So Tenet's the one, you know, that Christopher Nolan has said he doesn't want anything going out digitally. So that one going in there. But like you said, only select theaters. So how does that even really work for them, because their box office return is gonna be probably pretty small compared to what it could have been.
Yes, absolutely. And they're being extremely limiting with where the film is showing. Basically, they're not allowing it to even be shown in drive-in theaters at the moment in any states where the theaters, indoor theaters, aren't open, which seems like a really curious move. They're saying that it's to prevent piracy, but I'm not sure how that sort of, you know, compares to theaters, you know, drive-in theaters in other states where you can watch it, how that would affect things. But that's the sort of line they're drawing in the sand, that you can only see Tenet in theaters in the states where theaters are open. And you're just going to, I guess, have to risk it with coronavirus to see the film. I'm personally not sure that that's enough of a draw for me to gamble, to get into theaters to see this film. Unfortunately, I am going to have to wait until it hits the home entertainment market, or they sort of change their policies, because they're also not really sending out any screeners to critics or reviewers or things like that, because they really want to just push people into indoor theaters to see this film. You know, it's a bold strategy.
Yeah, I mean, it, you know, looks interesting, but like you said, I don't care to really risk anything to go see Tenet. The Bill and Ted, I do want to see, but you don't have to go to a theater for that one.
Absolutely, and I have seen it, and my review of the film will be up on Digital Trends later today. So I'm not allowed to say whether I liked it yet.
Okay.
But you can see Bill and Ted Face the Music. You can see Bill and Ted Face the Music tomorrow, both in theaters and via on demand. It's a $20 or $25 rental to stream the film via on demand on sort of on your on demand service of choice, Apple TV, Amazon, whatever, you know, whatever is most convenient for you. But it will also be in theaters, both indoor theaters and drive-in theaters. And let's just say I recommend seeing it, especially if you are a Bill and Ted fan. I've seen it, like I said, and I've interviewed the writers and the director, and all of those have gone up on Digital Trends this week. And this was a really fun experience as someone who grew up with the original films.
I will definitely be watching it. That's going to be the first one, actually, that I do rent in this kind of new era of these things. So, yeah, awesome. Bill and Ted. So some actual movies coming out, and then New Mutants as well. Going from there, what are some other things that we can watch and stream?
Well, one of the really cool things that it's coming to Netflix this weekend is Cobra Kai. The Cobra Kai series that's basically a sequel to the Karate Kid movies. It was originally a YouTube TV production, and now it is headed over to Netflix. Seasons 1 and 2 will be premiering on Netflix August 28th. It's a great show. I was very skeptical going into it, to be honest, but it really won me over the first season. It tells a story of Johnny Lawrence and Daniel LaRusso as adults and living in their old hometown. And Daniel LaRusso really is a local celebrity, and Johnny Lawrence has sort of bottomed out in his life after you know, losing to Daniel LaRusso in the championship in that original film. So this sort of, it goes on where Cobra Kai is reopened. Johnny sort of develops this, you know, renewed interest in teaching karate and reopening Cobra Kai. And it really humanizes him and makes him less of a villain and shows how, you know, these longstanding grudges can really shape people's lives.
I love it. A lot of nostalgia. And also, I have been wanting to watch that, but I didn't want to subscribe to YouTube for their service. That's great. That's going to be on Netflix. I will totally be watching that. So Cobra Kai coming to Netflix now for the first two seasons. And then there's something else on Hulu, and I read just a little bit about this. This is an interesting concept.
Yes, so a Hulu original movie, The Binge. It comes out also on August 28th. And it is a movie sort of like, it takes the premise of the Purge films, where, you know, all crime is legal for a single 24-hour period. But with this one, it does drugs and alcohol. The premise is it's set in a world where all drugs and alcohol are free and legal. I don't know about free, actually, but they're legal for 24 hours. And it follows a group of high school students who are experiencing their first binge day. Vince Vaughn is in the film playing a professor and a parent of one of the characters. And, you know, it looks like one of those sort of raunchy, irreverent comedies that's, you know, it's going to make you laugh at a time when, you know, there's a lot of serious things going on. This might provide a few laughs for you.
Yeah, I think anything like that is good at this point. So that just, it does look kind of ridiculous. So I will definitely be watching that too. So that's The Binge on Hulu, movies going back to the theater, Cobra Kai coming to Netflix. That's a solid round of entertainment there for this next coming week. And I do want to read, so I just want to reemphasize for everybody that your review of Bill and Ted is going to be up on the site. You said later today.
Yes, absolutely. Later on today, it's going to be up on the site. Yeah, definitely give it a read. It is spoiler-free, I assure you.
Okay, good. Yes, I will definitely be reading that later on. Rick, as always, so nice to have you on here to talk about entertainment and keeping us up to date with everything. And we will talk to you next week.
Great chatting movies and TV with you all the time.
Rick Marshall right here on Digital Trends Live. And again, all of his articles and reviews, they're fantastic. He said he's got a bunch of other ones too for Bill and Ted and everything else that we've been talking about. It's all up there at Digital Trends. So go there and check out everything and hit subscribe to join our show here every single weekday. Let me tell you about tomorrow. We've got Ciara Pressler back for another edition of Work Wife. We've got Lisa Marie Segarra who's going to be joining me for a special edition of Tech Briefs. And on top of that, we've got some other fantastic news. We're going to be talking about all of our everything that's going on in the world of entertainment. We've got Natalie Eva Marie. Yes, the wrestler. Natalie Eva Marie. She's going to be here on the show tomorrow. So you're not going to want to miss that. And thanks, everybody, for joining us again. Hit subscribe. Thanks for watching. I'm Greg Nibbler. I'll see you right back here tomorrow with another edition of Digital Trends Live.